So we are now going to start actually 3D equilibrium. So once we have covered the 2D equilibrium, then it will be easy to understand the 3D equilibrium. The only point is that we have to keep in mind is the supports and connections. So those, you know, how to realistically model the supports and connections, what are the forces and moments are coming as a reactions from the supports. So that is what we are going to discuss briefly. And then we are simply going to solve again many problems, because as such, you know, 2D and 3D equilibrium conceptually it's very simple as you have seen, but we have to solve a large number of problems to give a flavor to the students of different nitty-gritty. So the 3D equilibrium, as we know that now we are going to have the 6 scalar equation instead of 3 scalar equations. That means we said that resultant force equals to 0 and moment resultant is 0. So each one will produce 3 equilibrium conditions, right? So total we are going to have 6 equilibrium conditions to explore. And for a given rigid body, therefore, we can actually solve for 6 unknown constants that are coming from as a support reactions, let's say. So we can solve for these 6 reactions, support reactions, and we can say that problem is statically determinate as long as we have exactly 6 unknowns, so 6 support reactions. Now, it is important to understand that there could be problem where we actually have more than 6 unknowns as support reactions, but it is still okay. It is not necessary that we have to always solve a statically determinate problem. The problem can be statically indeterminate, but some of the desired forces can be solved, okay? So let's just quickly go through various types of supports and reactions that we see. First of all, the most simplified version would be just a ball, and on top of that ball we have this member. Or let's say a member is just resting on a frictionless surface. So when we are looking at the equilibrium of this body, we are trying to look at the free body diagram rather, then we are actually going to say that there is one support reaction is coming into play. So the concept of support reaction will be very similar to that of the 2D equilibrium. In one sentence, if I have to say, how do I determine the support reaction? See, in 3D equilibrium, we have 6 degrees of freedom, right? 3 translational component, 3 rotational component. That means, if a degrees of freedom is prevented, in that degrees of freedom, therefore, we are going to get the reaction, okay? So that is in one sentence, we can just state like that. If a degrees of freedom is prevented, there we are going to get the reaction back, okay? So if we look at this way, then all the, you know, support reactions can be very easily understood. So in this case, we can clearly say, see that the support, you know, the movement of the body is actually restricted in this direction, right? And therefore, we are going to get this support reaction, just one support reaction. Similarly, for a cable which is attached to the body, if we want to draw the free body diagram, again, the motion is only prevented along the direction of the cable. And therefore, we are going to get this as a reaction onto the body. So let's move on to the next one, roller on a rough surface. So if the surface is rough, that means we are actually going to have friction rather. So we can say the roller is free to rotate, that is not an issue. But we are going to get a friction force which is perpendicular to the, you know, on the horizontal direction in the plane, we are going to get a reaction this way, right? Because there is a friction force that is coming into play, and that is actually going to prevent the motion on that direction. So that degrees of freedom will be also prevented. So we are actually going to see two reactions here, and both reactions are actually force reactions, right? Remember, the rotation is allowed in all three directions, right? Also, the roller can actually translate in this direction, which we can say x axis. So therefore, there is no force as a reaction. There are no moments as a reaction. Okay. So let's go to one more step ahead. Now we are talking about a ball and socket joint. So what is this? Basically, we have the, you know, member which has a ball head, and that is put in a cup. Okay, so that's the representation of a ball and socket joint. So ultimately, the translational motion is prevented for this body in all three directions. Therefore, I am going to get the support reactions in all these three translational directions. So I will have three translational forces, three concentrated forces as the reaction. However, the motion, when we look at the rotational motion, that is allowed in every direction. That means about any axis, it can actually rotate. So I should not have any kind of moment reaction in this case. So the best example is actually our hip joint. This is just a representation of a ball and socket joint. The other one that I have presented here is that of a solar roof panel on a frame structure. You can see that ball is going into this cup. Now let's look at the other, you know, type of connections that are used. For example, we have the universal joint. Now, universal joint is, used in many cases, especially when we see the, you know, gears, rotational gears and so on and so forth. So in this case, actually, what it is that, let's say, we have two small members that are welded together. So you have these crossbars, but they are actually hinged at the two ends. Okay, so they are actually hinged at the two ends. Therefore, what is happening now, the body can actually, the motion that will be the rotational motion that is prevented is actually about its own axis. Right? When we are looking at the free body of the member itself, so what the member cannot do is basically go like this, about its own axis. So therefore, I should have a movement as a reaction which is about its own axis. Okay, so that movement is coming into play. But remember, what can happen, since here and here we have the hinge or pin connection, so the rotation will be allowed about the F, Z axis, as well as rotation will be allowed about the Y axis. So we are not going to have any moment reaction in these cases. Okay, so ultimately we are going to have four reactions in this case, three concentrated forces and one moment reaction. Now hinge and bearing. In case of a bearing, see, bearings are usually used for, where we have to have the radial load, right? So in case of a radial load, we actually use these bearings, okay? Now, In this case, if this is so, then therefore the body is only allowed to rotate about again its own axis. Therefore, I should not have any moment reaction, but body should not rotate about the y axis and about the z axis. Therefore, we should have now two moments in this case as a reaction. Okay. And also note that in this case, the body can actually also translate along its own axis. So this is not a thrust bearing. If it's a thrust bearing, then what happens? You can actually apply an axial load also. And to prevent the motion on the axial direction, I must have a support reaction back. So that is actually represented in the next case. So there are two typical cases. One is that without a thrust bearing, and another one is with a thrust bearing. Okay. So in one case, I don't have the axial load in its direction, in its axis. In the other case, I have the axial, reaction. Okay. And typical example of a hinge, very good examples we see day-to-day life is that of a door, let's say. So what the door can do, actually, it can rotate about the axis of the hinge. So that is the only motion that is allowed. Therefore, I should not have moment reaction about its own axis. But all other reactions should be present in the free body. Okay. So hinge connections is typically given a lot when we are trying to look at various types of problems. Also, the bearing will come into place and the ball socket joint will come into place more often. Okay. So with this, we can directly try to solve the problems. So I will just take an example here. So let's say this window is temporarily held open in this position by a wooden prop. So let's say there is some problem with the cranking mechanism and I just want to keep the window in some position. So I use a wooden prop to support that window. Okay. And remember that we also have two hinges here at A and B. Okay. It has its own weight. So the idea is here that we want to calculate what is the compressive force in that wooden prop. Problem is simple. But there are special tricks that we are going to use. So remember, in 3D equilibrium, we are never, we do not really recommend the students to really work on lambda dot r cross, take a moment about a point. We really try to work on lambda dot r cross f, that is moment of a force about an axis. So every time we try to take the moment about an axis to solve the problem. Okay. So in this case, therefore, what would be my solution key? First of all, let us say that how many unknowns do I have in this problem? If I have hinge here and hinge here, so hinge should have 5 unknowns. So I have 2 hinges, therefore I have 10 unknowns here as reactions. Also, I should have the force as an unknown. So there are total 11 unknowns. So not everything can be solved. So in the question, just quickly it is asked, how can I solve this force in member CD? So now we look at this way, that there is no moment reaction about line AB, right? So once this is said that there is no moment reaction about the line AB, then we can actually take the equilibrium about that line AB. So I take the moment of the forces that are acting in the window about the axis AB. So that is the only conclusion we can make. And I can get that directly. I can solve for the force directly. So now here is the key. this force FCD has an infinite line of action. So what we are looking at, we are typically looking at the free body diagram of the window, right? So I'll just jump on to the next slide. So this is the free body diagram. I have the little force FCD here, and I also have the weight at the mass center of the window. Now, once I want to take the moment about the line AB, what would be the best way to do it? Resolve into components, but where? Someone said that it is going to be D. Now, if I resolve it into D, then what happens? How many components are actually giving out the moment about AB? How many components? Two components, right? One would be the FCD along X, and another one is the FCD along Y. So two components of that force FCD will give the moment about AB. So naturally, we have to take both into account to get the moment about line AB. But remember, I can also resolve this force CD at point C without violating any equilibrium. So once I resolve it at C, then what will happen, that FCDY, that will pass through AB. So Y component of the force CD will not come into picture when we are taking the moment about AB. Only component that will contribute is the X component. And that is the simplest way to solve this problem. Okay. So this is one of the, you know, beautiful thing when we are trying to look at 3D equilibrium. Where should I resolve the force? I am sure in 2D equilibrium, probably you have seen similar scenarios that where should I resolve the force such that I can take, you know, a minimum contribution from the force components are going to come into the moment equilibrium. So as such, the problem remains very simple, except for the fact that one has to calculate the force FCD. That means we have to now find out what are the components of the FCD along X direction, along Y direction, and along Z direction. Although we should not be bothered about these two. So all I am interested in finding out what is the component of CD along X, and that is 0.828 FCD. Okay? So once we do that, now it's very simple because weight is actually acting at the mass center, and it has its distance. That distance can be easily found, right? The perpendicular distance. And we also know there is a FCDX, and the perpendicular distance is simply 0.8 meter. So through this, we can very quickly solve the problem. Just one moment equation and one component of the force is coming into from the reaction FCD. One component of the force is just balancing the weight. Okay, the moment due to the weight. So the answer will be 227 newton. Next problem. Is that of a signboard, and this signboard is actually held in position by two cables, as well as there are some supports. That supports are properly defined here. So support at D is that of a ball and socket joint. So we should have three reactions here, force reactions, right, in X, Y, and Z direction. And what is also said that at point C, the point C was said to be ball and socket joint, and point D here, we have actually, you know, in Y direction, there is only a support. Okay, so there is a ball and socket joint at C, and there is just a Y direction, right, force in D. So now how I am going to solve this problem? So is it a, first of all, statically determinate problem? How many reactions do I have? I have three reactions here, all force reactions, sorry, all force reactions at C, right? Three forces. I just have one force here, so total four, and then these two, therefore total I have six unknowns. Now this problem is perfectly statically determinate. Now one important thing we can observe here is that if we just look at the x-axis, we can see that a number of forces are passing through this x-axis. That is T1, T2, there is dy. And only thing is that except for the cy, nothing contributes to the moment about x-axis. That is a very important, you know, point here. Except for cy, which is coming from the ball and socket joint, no other force is contributing to the moment about x-axis. Therefore, what is cy? First of all, cy has to be equals to. So now to find these unknowns, first thing is that we can simply take a moment about the x-axis and just make sure that cy equals to 0. Okay. Then other five unknowns can be solved very systematically. For example, if I just take a moment about the z-axis, let's say, if I take moment about z-axis, then I can find a relationship between T1 and T2. That is done. Then another important point here is that let's take a moment about AB. If I take a moment about AB, what do I find? Remember, this C is shown as a resultant of the three forces, Cx, Cy, and Cz. Okay, so actually we have already said that Cy is going to be equals to 0. That is what we have said. There is still Cx and Cz. Now once I take a moment about AB, I can easily find the force Cx. Why? Because T1 and T2 is already passing through the AB. Right? They do not contribute. So we just take a moment about the Cx. Cz is also passing through AB, and this R, that is also parallel to y-axis, so does not contribute in the moment about AB. So only thing that is contributing moment about AB is the Cx and the moment of this weight. So we balance that, take a moment about AB equals to 0, and therefore we can find the Cx. So once that is found, then we can actually explore the, you know, other equilibrium conditions. So we take a moment about z axis, and that I, as I said, that moment about z axis will actually give a relationship between T1 and T2. Let's say that is that equation I have in my hand. And then we will just simply say that sum of force along x equals to 0. So sum of force along x equals to 0, we'll now have T1 and T2 components. So x components of T1 and T2 will come into play, and as well as Cx. Now Cx is already solved. Cx was solved from the previous step. So therefore we can now say what is T1 and T2. So through this process, we eventually solved actually four, you know, unknowns so far. And then we can do the, you know, explore the other equations. So sum of force along y direction equals to 0, and sum of force along z equals to 0. This will solve for the other two remaining unknowns, that is r and the cz. So now we move on to problem number 3. So far we have just talked about a single rigid body. So single rigid body, I may or may not have 6 unknowns, let's say, to solve. But problem can, you know, some unknowns can always be found. Now we are going to talk about multibody. That means more than one body is connected. Then how I am going to solve for the unknowns? Okay. So in this problem, again, what is being stated is that there are two bars, AB and OD, they are pinned together at C. Okay, so there is a pin connection here. So it's almost like a, you know, it's like a scissor. And we have ball and socket joints at O and A. And also, there is a cable, that is cable is BE. A vertical load is being applied. So find the components of reactions at A and O. Okay, so two bodies are connected and we are going to find out that what are the reactions at A and O. Now try to just understand that how many unknowns we have in this problem. And you can see that if you look at globally, without detaching the bodies, there are two rigid bodies. So ultimately, we can actually say that, you know, if it is statically determinate, then I have to show that there are 12 unknowns indeed. And from each rigid body, there are 6 equilibrium equations. So 12 equilibrium equations can solve the problem. Okay. Now let us try to find out if there are actually 12 unknowns here or not. Okay. So we can see here that since A and O are ball and socket joint, therefore, I have 3 reactions here, force reaction, 3 force reactions at O, total 6, plus 1 from the cable, 7, right? And then, right here, we also have a hinge. Now, that hinge, what it can actually do, the only thing that it can do is move about an axis that is perpendicular to its plane, right? So, there is no moment reaction about that axis, that is, you know, axis that is passing through C parallel to Y, CY axis, let's say. So there should not be just any moment, but in all other directions, we are going to get the moment. So we draw the free body diagram and just solve step by step in this case. So what can happen actually, even if we just look at the without detaching the bars, let's say I just want to, you know, solve the unknowns. So few unknowns can be solved, not all the unknowns can be solved, but a few unknowns can be solved still. So what we'll do, we'll go step by step. So now as we can see that let's take a moment about an axis that is about the x-axis here in this case. So this is x-axis is passing through O here. So we have assumed this is our origin. So in this case, we clearly see that ultimately what we are going to get, the moment contribution is given by AY and P. So we can find the relationship between this. So AY can be solved just by taking the moment about the x-axis. Okay. Next, let's explore also moment about z-axis. What that will give? That will directly solve the force in the cable, right? Because we take the component of this force, that is T sine of 45 degree, and multiply by the distance, and that should be equals to P times A. So we get the cable force T.
Moments about OX line. What is the distance, perpendicular distance of force P from OX line?
Just, I think it is A. Okay. It's all A, okay?
This side is
okay. So now we do, since you know some of the forces are known, for example, T we have already solved, so we can just go like this, sum of force along Y. Ultimately, what will happen that I will be able to find actually 5 unknowns from this, if we keep doing this kind of operations, but then, you know, we won't be able to find the all unknowns, okay? So now what we have to do, we just have to detach one of the member and expose the, you know, unknowns at C. And from there, we can just take the equilibrium of the detached body and try to solve for the unknown force, okay? So ultimately, remember, in this case, we have solved AX, AY, that is solved, and OX, Y, that is solved, also T is solved. So what we do not know yet is that AZ and OZ. Now once we detach one of the bars, so this bar is being detached, there is actually a small mistake here. So the way to look at it, so if I really have to draw it, there is a moment reactions missing in this problem. Okay, so remember there should not be any moment about this axis as a reaction, but we should have the moment reaction about the Cx axis and about the Cz axis. Okay, so that was just a simple mistake it has got. But ultimately what will happen, now since there is no moment reaction about the Cy axis, so we can take a moment about this axis equals to zero, and what it will give, it will immediately give a relationship between Ox and Oz. So Ox and Oz, that once we know that, then remember we had already solved for the Ox, that was equals to P. So Oz will be also equals to P. So here the idea was, unless otherwise I detach this body, I won't be able to solve for one of the unknowns that was left over. Okay. So ultimately, all of the unknowns can be found through this process just by taking the equilibrium about different axes and the forces and the force equilibrium. So the next problem will again be a multi-body problem. So what is being done here, actually we have three identical balls, each of mass m, are placed in the cylindrical ring which rests on a horizontal surface. And the height of this ring is slightly greater than the radius of the ball. Diameter of the ring is such that the balls are virtually touching one another. That is an important point to observe. And then these three balls are actually virtually touching to each other. And then we are going to put a fourth ball on the top. So what is being asked is that determine the force P exerted by the ring on each of the three lower balls. So once we do that, once we dump that ball on the top, basically, there will be tendency to spread over, and that is why we are going to get the reaction back from the ring. Okay. So now how do I approach for this problem? Remember that there are point contacts between the balls, right? And this point contact will give the reactions. So you are going to get basically contact forces here, and that contact force line of action will be from center to center. Okay. So we can basically think of a tetrahedron. If we join the centers of four balls, then we are going to get a tetrahedron. So how this reaction is happening is basically through the edge of this tetrahedron. Okay. So now once we take the equilibrium of the top ball, remember, all these reactions, three reactions forces will be identical, right? And we can simply take the vertical equilibrium of the top ball to find the reaction first. So contact reaction can be found that way. And then we'll simply go to the lower ball for the equilibrium, right? Because lower ball will also have a force that is exerted by the ring on the ball. Also, it will have a reaction from the bottom. Okay, so these are the two equilibrium that we are going to explore. As I said, just concept would be simply to think about a tetrahedron right here, which is connecting the centers of these four balls. That's the only thing we have to tell the students probably. Okay, and then they will get to know, okay, then I can actually look at the problem from the top view. So what I have created here is a top view. And then another view that we have taken is that of a, let's say, if we pass a plane that is, to the AO axis, right, going like this. So we take a slice actually, and that, view can also be explored. Okay, so these are the two views I required to solve this problem. So in the first case, remember the reactions are passing through the edges. If we look at the equilibrium of the top ball, okay? And therefore, what is necessary to find out just this angle, that little angle theta is what that is controlling everything. Okay, that is the, you know, angle that we have to find out. And once we do the equilibrium of the top ball, we should be able to find out what is the R, that reaction. Okay, and that reaction is now came back to the lower ball. When we are taking the equilibrium of the lower ball, then that reaction is here along with a force P, which we want to find out, as well as there is a normal reaction. But I am not interested in the normal reaction, so therefore we can just set sum of force equals the sum of force along x direction equals to 0, and we get the result. So the only issue here would be the calculation of theta, and that have to be done using the, you know, geometry of the problem. So as such, as I said, that we are really going to work on multiple problems. So I just demonstrated few problems where we have seen, you know, difficulty. Especially this problem, students have some difficulty in visualization, and also that multi-body, you know, problem where you really have to detach the bar and how the, you know, conditions of equilibrium will be used about the various axes, that needs to be understood.